This is a piece of music written originally for the double bass. It's been transcribed for hundreds of different instruments, and tonight the tuba. It's a sonata in four movements. We hope you enjoy the sonata by Henry Eccles.
Thank you. Thank you.
1982, I was a member of the BBC Symphony Orchestra in London, and that gave me access to a number of composers that I otherwise would not have met. They came to work with an orchestra that really didn't have to sell tickets to an audience. We were a radio orchestra, and we could play basically anything that we liked, and that meant that the orchestra had a real specialty for playing avant-garde music, which hardly exists anymore, or cutting-edge modern music. One of the composers that I was able to interact with was the composer of this next piece. She's called Sofia Gubaidulina. She's in her 90s now, and she's a very deeply religious composer, a Catholic composer. And she wanted to write a lament about the death of Jesus Christ. So this is an Easter, if you like, a passion piece written for the tuba. And I think, what better instrument is there to express miserableness? We do that really well on the bow brass, and especially the tuba. Now, it's a magnum opus for the tuba. That means it has 7 pages. You know, we don't usually get 7 pages on the tuba. So, with your indulgence, I'll put a few more music stands up here. And because it's a piece of Russian music, the Russian tuba players generally play what we would call a contrabass tuba or a B-flat tuba. And most tuba soloists, when they come around to universities like this and give a recital, they play on the bass tuba. That's this small one here, this baby one here. But most of the students that are here and in other universities, particularly if they're at the undergraduate stage, they play mostly the big tuba in C or in B flat. They play in the marching band, then they're probably playing a B flat tuba or a B flat sousaphone. So it's difficult for people who play those big instruments to have a reference about how they might sound. So because I'm playing today in a university, one that's very special to me because I come here relatively often, I thought for the students' sake and for mine and for the music's sake, I'll bring my contrabass tuba for this piece. And you'll find that apart from the depth of the sound that the instrument has, there's an amazing effect when we play to the piano. Just do the piano. Sunshine and the clouds and happiness and pretty little tunes, then where would the art be? Let's hope you enjoy Lamento by Sofia Gubaidulina. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very hard to find repertoire that's challenging and fun for that instrument. So I thought, well, the best thing that I can do is instead of complaining about it, I could try and write a piece myself. So the Steel City, as being referred to in the title, is of course my new home city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Yes, somebody clapped there, yeah. Yes, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And, well, as you know, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania is famous for its steel, or it used to be. There are a couple of steelworks still working, not many. But it's much more famous for its sporting teams. And, well, before moving to Pittsburgh, I was never a fan of really any sports, except maybe soccer, maybe, just a bit. But only if Scotland were playing England. Then I was interested. But since moving to Pittsburgh, I got really into the Steelers, the Penguins, don't boo, and also, unfortunately for me, the Pittsburgh Pirates. I was a season ticket holder of the Pittsburgh Pirates. So I thought I would try and incorporate some of the things that are that pertain to the sports team. So the first one is called Wall of Steel, and that refers to the defense of the Pittsburgh Steelers back in the day. And originally the piece was called Three Steel City Scenes, but the publisher, when I sent him the music, said, you know that there are four movements, don't you? And I hadn't noticed. The second movement is a song, an aria. Just nice, because it's nice to play a nice song on the tuba. The third movement refers to the baseball team. It's called a wacky waltz. And the fourth movement is called March Penguinese. It's a march by the Pittsburgh Penguins. And you'll hear this, those of you that are sharp-eared, and I know we're in a music school, so we're going to hear that. There's a homage to our number 87, and he is Mr. Crosby from Canada. There's, yeah, somebody put the thumbs down. Hey, we're all passionate about sports, aren't we? So there's a homage to him with the Canadian National Anthem, but there's another sports team, well, kind of sports team, in Pittsburgh, to which I'm connected, and that is the Pittsburgh Ballet Theatre. So you might hear, if you're sharp-eared enough, a little quote from Swan Lake in homage of the Pittsburgh Ballet Theatre. This is Steel City Scenes. The book,
Thank you.
Did you enjoy the Steel City Scenes? It's a lot of fun, and if anybody wants to try and have a go playing it, it's fantastic on the C tuba, fantastic on the B flat tuba. And I had some really talented students this afternoon in the masterclass, and so it'd be great. I'll leave a copy with you, and then you can have a go.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So, in other recitals, the recitalist usually goes off into the wings and mops their fevered brow. But that's kind of dull for the audience, particularly when there's no bar. So what I thought I'd do is I'd come down, and if anybody's got any questions for me, please feel free to ask, and I'll do my best. So anybody with a question, some of the masterclass people this afternoon were told, hey, have a question ready, and yeah. Yeah.
I was going to ask this earlier, but we had a class. So as a French horn player, sometimes you play the pedal tone as well. Does the same jaw factor apply as much as your lips or your mouthpiece? Is the same as you told him earlier, does the same thing apply? Or is it?
Yeah, definitely applies. So I use some horn methods as well. I use Gunter Schuller, the unaccompanied horn studies, which are great for the range. But I also like to play Neuling Bagatelle. Not the best piece, but it's great for developing the low register. You could do that easily on the C tube, or just write that. I think I have a part I can write out for you. But for sure, if I watch my colleagues from the Pittsburgh Symphony, the low horn players are all sticking that lower jaw forward. You look as though you're absolutely made for that, if you don't mind me saying so.
Yeah,
you've definitely got that. You've definitely got that lower jaw pointing forward. You'd be a fantastic tuba player. Have you thought of switching? Well, you know, one of the best tuba players in the world ever, arguably, was John Fletcher. And he was a horn player, and a very good horn player, I heard him. And they needed a tuba player in the Cambridge University Orchestra, and he happened to be available. They put one in his hand, and the rest is history. Yeah, so yeah, not trying to wean you off the horn onto the tuba, but yes, I am. Yeah, it's a good question. Any others? Yes, sir. Say again, I couldn't quite hear.
Phil Jones Ensemble. I was a member of the Phil Jones Ensemble from 1980 until about 1985 or 6 when it stopped. This was the best thing I did at the Sanders and Gregory by Sanders playing. But Phil Jones himself was a great mentor to me, and so was Elmer Howarth. I still call him Uncle Elmer. He allows me to do that. And others, so when I was in that group, I was in my early 20s, so you can imagine I was incredibly impressionable. I was in 21, 22 when I joined that group. And so I was just like a sponge for them, and probably a real pain, because I kept asking questions of how to do that. Hey, Mr. Jones, how to do that? And he was, Phil Jones was a great, great chamber music player, a great musician. His legacy, I think, lives on with the recordings which are still out there, and also with patients that did back in the day, just for us, some people still playing. But it was an amazing, a really amazing group. We toured the world together. I saw Phil's trumpets being demolished by a bus which ran over them. So all kinds of experiences like that. And we had a wonderful time. It still informs my music making to this day, it's like 1980s. It still informs the way that I work with brass ensembles. I'm not even going to say brass bands now, because for me, a group of brass players is an ensemble, and it has the same rules, which is get the balance right, get the ensemble right, don't blast the walls out. Maybe there's once or twice in a concert when you want to play full lines, and that's exciting. But if it's like full on the whole time, it's less exciting. Those are the rules that still apply. All of the ensemble, wind ensemble, orchestra, whatever it is. I have to hear the melody, whoever has it, I need to hear that first. Then I need to have the bass line, whoever has that. Could be anything, could be second flute, who knows. And then the harmony. And then if there's a counter melody, then that counter melody comes into the third place, and the poor old harmony goes off the podium, you know, like Scotland, that's what I'm getting there. And the trouble is that the composers just write forte or piano, mezzo piano, for everybody. But you know, if you put forte for the second flute on a low D or an E, it's going to be different from forte on a second trumpet and the horn. So these are the things that Philip taught me. He would say to me, for example, you have the melody. And I'd say, hey, Mr. Jones, it's marked mezzo piano. He said, I don't give it that. You have the melody, that's you. And then other times I would say, what are you doing? You've only got 40. You're unimportant there. Those kind of things that really informed my whole music making life. That's a really good question. Are you a fan? Do you listen to that? Oh, you can sing with French. Out in the East. Oh, congratulations. That was really amazing. That was
What's the weather like in Scotland? Several of these shirts, and I've never really admitted to this in public before, but I'm a country music fan, and I wasn't always a country music fan, but I went on a walking tour of Nashville, because you know, if you're not from the United States, you think, oh, Nashville, Johnny Cash, the famous Scottish singer. It was. Johnny Cash, would you check him out? He has Scottish ancestry, and Johnny Cash's aunt lived in our village, Mrs. Cash. So she was always talking about her cousin Johnny, and we thought, it can't be the same, but it turned out it was the same. So I went to Nashville, and I thought, okay, I know nothing about this. And this young man took us on a walking tour and said, this is where this person lives, and that's where, and I had no idea who he was talking about. So I thought, I'm a curious person, I thought, I have to research this. So I bought about 70 CDs of country music at Ernest Tubb's record store. Ernie Tubb was a country singer back in the 50s and 60s. And he still has there's still a record store named after him. So I came back and just crammed all these CDs, and I really got into the spirit of it. And then a friend of mine decided that because I'm a country music fan, they would buy me this shirt. He bought me two. The other one is louder. The other one is even louder. But it's a very comfortable thing for a concert.
Very nice.
Yeah, this is a great news. This is not rude at all. This is great. So you don't have your white shirt, you don't have to iron that, but you can go.
Eagles.
Okay, good. Last question before you have to suffer my playing again. All right, good. Well, yeah. My daily routine. Yeah, I can. Yeah, I have every day. I do more or less the same thing. So okay, probably best do that on the horn. So my day starts around 5:30 a.m. And it starts with fitness because, you know, we use our bodies to play big instruments like this. We have to carry them for a start. Breathing is a big thing. So when one gets past the age of 30 or 30, the breathing starts to go down a bit. So I'm going to get a couple of things from the side stage. About 40 minutes on an exercise bike, and that's just basically to get the breathing and the upper body to be fit. And then I take the horn. The first thing I do is buzzing, and I buzz with the mouthpiece a little bit, but mostly I buzz with no mouthpiece. I keep telling people, this is like a preamplifier. This is the sound source. So if that's working really well, then you can probably make a decent sound. It's not easy to do a nice free buzz at first, but perseverance will do it. You notice it takes a lot of air. pitches so that, you know, when I come to the horn, that they actually are the notes I'm buzzing. I come onto the horn, the first thing I do are scales. Now, Jonathan Mendes will tell you, he will attest to the fact that I am a scales freak, and that in every lesson, every student has to play scales. And I learned that from a violin player that I played with once. It's Itzhak Perlman. He teaches at Juilliard, and there's a recording of him playing the second Prokofiev violin concert with the BBC Symphony Orchestra. I was on that session. Thank you, God. It was fantastic. And I said to him, look, what do you do every day? He said, scales, man. I said, okay, that's good enough for him. It's good enough for me. So how I do them is that I don't use any tongue. I just use air starts to the note. It goes a bit like this. Generally working in the cycle of fifths. What that does for me, it helps me keep the mouth open when I'm playing the notes. So it's like this. It helps me also find the resistance of each note and then adjust the air so that the sound is the same. That's what I want to do, to be even throughout the range. So that helps me do that. Funnily enough, it also helps articulation a bit later on. After I've done the scales with no tongue, I'll do the same scales, maybe minors, with a slur. Work through all the keys again in the cycle of fifths. And you can see what you do with the cycle of fifths. You're not starting high or really low. You're starting and extending the range into the high register and down into the lower register. So you're not killing yourself with this routine. You're really building up and extending. And then articulation exercises. Well, I use Arban a lot, as Jonathan will know. And I start at about page 11 and do 11 or 12, and I go from 11 to 50. This is this one. That goes through all the keys. Page 63. Go through all those major and minor scale exercises in the Arban, and then major and minor arpeggios. So instead of using the vowels for the very low notes, I'll use a false fingering, and that helps me just direct the A string down there. I usually start on the big horn and work up to the small horn and finish with the, because I do some euphonium these days, and I so finish with the euphonium. So I start with that one, or a B flat that I have in my studio, then I come to this one, then I go to the euphonium. And I do more or less the same things on each of the horns. And takes me a good an hour to an hour and a half, if I've got the time. And if I don't have the time, I do all of those things, but just, you know, fewer repetitions, so that it builds up strength and stamina. And above all, for me, at my age, the breathing, because, you know, that becomes the hardest thing. You know, that's the thing that you think, oh, I used to be able to play that phrase, and now So I just think, okay, split it in two. What's the deal? What's the big deal? And then find a way how to split it. Did I answer your question?
Well, it's more from students, but yeah.
Okay, let's play some more music, eh?
Yeah.
Great. Okay, let's welcome Roger Gray. Here he comes. Give him a big round of applause. By a dear friend of mine. He's called Martin Ellerby. He's written a ton of music for brass, and especially for the wind ensemble. I've known him. I met him first in 1979, and we've been really close friends ever since. He's written a couple of pieces for me. One is a tuba sonata, which I highly recommend. It's quite difficult, but if you playing the bass tuba, or the F tuba, or the E flat tuba, it's a major one for us and hardly ever performed. So again, if you would like a copy of that, get in touch with me and I'll make sure that that gets into your hands. This is his concerto. It's really in one movement, starts very lyrically, and then it just goes a bit crazy, doesn't it? Yeah, you could say that. Okay.
Thank you.
Collaborative pianist, because generally speaking, when we have tuba repertoire, the piano player has much harder parts than we have. So please give. We're going to end this recital with a lovely piece of music originally written for the horn by a great horn player, by all accounts, the father of Richard Strauss. This is Franz Strauss, and he's written a number of beautiful pieces for the horn, which I've stolen over the years. But I'm not the only one who steals music from the horn, because this exists in arrangement for the cello and all kinds of other instruments. Even the alto saxophone, or even the alto horn, would play this piece very nicely. It's called Nocturnal, very